Hello students, welcome to today's lecture on artificial neural networks. Today we will be discussing about an introduction to what is a linear support vector machine, and also we'll go through some important terminology related to this support vector machine. And at the end of the session we will be discussing about the important steps required to find out or to design a linear support vector machine for a given input class of patterns, input set of patterns. Okay, so this is our today's topic. In our previous class, we have seen some introductory concepts related to what is meant by pattern separability, and also we have seen what is a hyperplane and optimal hyperplane and the terminology related to that. And we also discussed, derived the formulas related to the optimal hyperplanes in a linear separability input space. Okay, so that is what we discussed in our earlier session. So this is a continuation of that video. If anyone is not watched that previous video, please watch that video first and then back to this video. Okay, so let us start with some introduction to what is the purpose of support vector machines involved in machine learning. So here is a small introduction to support vector machine. It is one of the most popular supervised learning algorithm. Most popular supervised learning algorithm. So it falls under supervised learning and used for classification purposes and also for regression purposes. Okay, so SVM can be used for either classification problems or regression problems also. That means for predictions. Okay, and basically SVM is meant for solving the classification problems in machine learning. So this is the introduction to SVM. It is actually a supervised learning algorithm which is meant for solving classification problems in machine learning. So that is what you need to remember. And the goal of SVM algorithm is to create the best line or decision boundary that can segregate n-dimensional space into several classes. That means if there are two input classes, then it divides, the decision boundary divides the input classes into two separate patterns like this. Okay, so it may be more also, it can divide n dimensional space also. For the best decision boundary, that means you may draw several decision boundaries that can segregate the corresponding input space into several classes, but among all those decision boundaries, the best decision boundary will be identified as optimal hyperplane or simply hyperplane of SVM. Okay, so SVM chooses this optimal hyperplane by considering the points in creating the hyperplane. That means if you observe this, this is called as positive hyperplane, as I explained earlier, and this is called as negative hyperplane. And if you observe, the closest point that defines this positive hyperplane is this particular point, and also the closest point that defines this negative hyperplane is this point. So these two are called as support vectors. So the SVM algorithm first identifies these support vectors, and then based on these two support vectors, it identifies the corresponding optimal hyperplane or the best decision boundary for the given problem. Okay. So just look at this diagram. I have explained about the terminology in previous class also. This diagram shows the basic terminology that you need to remember with respect to the decision boundaries and hyperplanes. Okay, this has maximum margin is the distance between positive hyperplane and negative hyperplane. Positive hyperplane is the decision boundary closest to the positive class input patterns, and the negative class hyperplane, that is negative hyperplane, is the decision boundary considered closest to the negative class inputs, and the point that is very closest to the negative hyperplane is called as support vector for the negative class, and the point which is closest to the positive hyperplane is called as support vector for the positive class. Okay, and this margin should be as maximum as possible to call it as a hyperplane of SVM. So the ultimate goal of SVM algorithm is to identify this maximum margin separation between a given set of input patterns. Okay. Right. Now, having understood the purpose of basic purpose of support vector machine, let us go through the types of SVM that we can design for a given set of problems. There are two possible types of SVM that we can design. One is linear SVM, and the other one is non-linear SVM. Okay, so depending on the properties of input classes given, we can use either linear SVM or non-linear SVM. So where we can actually use this linear SVM is if the input patterns are linearly separable, then we can design this linear SVM for classifying the corresponding linearly separable data. Okay, otherwise it is not possible to design this linear SVM for solving the given problem. Okay, so assuming that there is a binary classification problem, if a data set can be classified into two classes by using a single straight line, then we can say that it is linearly separable, and then only we can say that design of linear SVM is possible for the given set of data. Okay, so simply saying, if the input patterns are linearly separable, then you can design this linear SVM for the given set of inputs. Otherwise, that means if the inputs patterns are not linearly separable but non-linearly separable, then we can design non-linear SVM for such kind of data. Okay, so what is meant by linearly not separable or non-linearly separable? It means that the data set, the input patterns, cannot be classified by using a straight line. Okay, if you cannot classify the input patterns with the help of a straight line, then we can say that the data or the input patterns given are not linearly separable, or we can say it as non-linearly separable. Okay, so in such case, for the non-linear separable data, you have to use this design of non-linear SVM only. For that case, you cannot use linear SVM. The only possibility is non-linear SVM. Okay, so let us conclude where we can actually use linear SVM and non-linear SVM. Linear SVM is used if the input patterns are linearly separable. Otherwise, you have to use non-linear SVM only. Okay, so that is the conclusion about the types of support vector machines. And the important terminology that you should remember always while designing the support vector machines is, what is a hyperplane? So whenever we say hyperplane in terms of SVM, it's going to be the best hyperplane always. That is the best decision boundary, which we generally call it as optimal hyperplane. So either you call it as hyperplane or optimal hyperplane or the best decision boundary, all of them are going to be same here in SVM. Okay, so what is this hyperplane? As I explained earlier, if you have the input classes of patterns that can be divided into the n-dimensional space with the help of a straight line, then we call it as linearly separable. And the best boundary that separates the input patterns is called as hyperplane of SVM. Okay, and the dimensions of hyperplane depends on the features given in the data set. But if there are two features, then the hyperplane is going to be a straight line. So till now we have seen only this kind of separation. And if there are more features than two, then the hyperplane will become a two-dimensional plane. Okay, so we always create a hyperplane that has a maximum margin irrespective of the whether the input space is two-dimensional or not. Okay, so we always try to find out the maximum distance between the data points. So the more the maximum, the more the margin between the positive hyperplane and the negative hyperplane, the more effective the SVM algorithm works on a given set of input points. Okay, so the ultimate goal of the SVM is to identify the best decision boundary that contains the maximum distance between the data points. Okay, so that is what our goal is. So we'll see how to find out that maximum hyperplane, optimal hyperplane with the help of algorithm in this class itself. Okay, so then what do you mean by support vectors? As I explained earlier, these are the data points that are closest to the hyperplane and which affect the position of the hyperplane are called as support vectors. Okay, that means the closest points to the corresponding positive hyperplane and negative hyperplane. Okay, so you need to pick only one closest point. If you have more than one point with same distance to the corresponding boundary, you need to pick both of them as support vectors for the corresponding line. Okay, so equal distance points can be selected as support vectors for a particular hyperplane. But if there is only one point exists which is very close to the corresponding hyperplane, then there will be only one support vector for the corresponding hyperplane. So, as I explained earlier, see here, these two, when you compare, these two are actually close to this hyperplane. But compared to this point, this is the closest point to this positive hyperplane. So we pick this as support vector for this positive hyperplane. Similarly, this is the only closest point to this hyperplane. So this becomes a support vector. Okay, suppose, assume that if this point is also here, having the same distance as this point, then these two points can become support vectors for the hyperplane. So remember that point. While solving the problems, you need to properly pick the support vectors. Okay, you cannot omit the same distance points. If there are more than one point exist with same distance from the positive hyperplane that are close to the positive hyperplane or negative hyperplane, you should pick all those points which are with similar distance as support vectors. Okay, so I'll explain this later when we go through a solved example. Okay, right. Now coming to the linear SVM, the working of linear SVM algorithm, we can easily understand it with the help of a simple example. So imagine a situation where we have two classes of inputs. One is blue and the other one is green. Okay, so these are the tags given, and every point is identified with x1 and x2. Okay, so the pair x1 comma x2 defines the coordinates of these points as either green or blue. Okay, so now given a particular point x1 comma x2, we can identify whether it is belonging to this class or belongs to this class. Okay, so for this, to identify that class, what we will do is we will identify a hyperplane to separate these two categories, So if you observe this diagram, there are several possible hyperplanes for the same set of input patterns. But then the main aim of linear SVM will be to identify the best decision surface that contains maximum margin, that contains maximum margin between these two classes. Okay, so we need to identify that particular hyperplane, which is termed as optimal hyperplane or simply hyperplane of SVM. Okay, so as shown in this diagram, see, you can draw a line, a negative hyperplane here, and then this becomes the support vector because this is the closest point to this hyperplane. So this is a support vector for negative hyperplane. Similarly, this becomes the optimal, this is actually the positive hyperplane, and this becomes the only support vector for this hyperplane. After identifying these support vectors, then we need to identify a decision boundary that separates these support vectors with a maximum margin. So the remaining points we don't consider, but we need to identify the maximum margin between the support vectors that are identified. Okay, so the steps that will be used in identifying the optimal hyperplane will be first identifying the support vectors and then identifying the decision boundary that separates these two support vectors with a maximum margin. Okay, so that is what we are going to do, right? So that's what I explained here. SVM algorithm finds the closest point of the lines from both of the classes. We call them as support vectors, and the distance between the vectors and the hyperplane is called as margin. That means this is called margin. Okay, so the goal of SVM is to maximize this margin as maximum as possible. Okay, the hyperplane with maximum margin is said to be optimal hyperplane. That is what we need to understand. And the goal of SVM is to find this optimal hyperplane that segregates our input patterns into two classes here. Okay. And when it comes to the margins, it's not always to find out the best margin of separation. Sometimes there may be several possibilities of identifying the margins. Let us go through the types of margins. Okay, so always we try to arrive at the best margin, but the other possibilities are also there. Let us start with the good margin. Good margin means that it is the best boundary surface, and all the vectors, that is support vectors, have the same distance with the maximum margin hyperplane. So if you consider these support vectors, there are three support vectors on positive side and the two support vectors on negative side. All of them will have same distance from the hyperplane. So if you can identify a decision boundary something like this, you can call it as a good margin, the best margin for your classification problem. Okay, but then there is a possibility of bad margins also. If you look at this example, the boundary surface, that is the decision surface, is very close to this positive boundary. Okay, so in bad margin, what happens is generally the decision surface, the decision boundary, is going to be close to one particular class of input patterns. So either towards the positive class or towards the negative class. So if something is identified like this, then that margin is called as a bad margin. This is not at all a required margin for your problem. You should avoid this kind of margins while solving the classification problems. Okay, so this is the kind of bad margins we should avoid while solving the classification problems. But then there are two other kinds of margins that we can identify. One is hard margin and the other one is soft margin. Okay, hard margin, look at this diagram. What we have here is, in hard margin, we can select two parallel hyperplanes that separate the two classes of data so that the distance between them is as large as possible. Okay, so you can see it here. This is one possible hyperplane, and this is another hyperplane, and also the support vectors are defined like this. So in hard margin, we pick the points that are very close to the hyperplane, and the distance between these two points are going to be similar. Okay, same. It's going to be same. And also, either you can draw a hyperplane here or here also. Okay, so that is possible. So with hard margin, and coming to the soft margin, generally hard margins are going to support the linear separable data, whereas in soft margin, if the data is not fully linear separable, then we will allow some margin violation to occur. This is called margin violation. Means that if you observe this and this, every point that is falling here that belongs to this class, that is green class, and every point that comes under this line that is called as a red class. Okay, but if you observe this soft margin, we allow some error. That means there may be few points, few inputs from this red class may fall into other side of the margin that we identify. Okay, so if you observe a red dot is here, there is no way of identifying a decision boundary that makes this red dot belongs to this class. Or if you find some line something like this, then these two will fall into other side. Okay, so soft margin allows a bit of error that allows one class of patterns goes to the other side of the hyperplane, the optimal hyperplane. Okay, whereas in hard margin, it is not possible. Exactly, we draw two hyperplanes, and whatever best decision boundary we identified, whatever appears on one side of that belongs to one class, and the other side of that best decision boundary belongs to other class in hard margin. So there is no margin of error identified here. So we don't allow it. It is a strict margin or hard margin. Okay. Whereas in soft margin, we allow a margin of error here. That means one class of input patterns may fall into, or maybe wrongly identified as other class. We allow like that. A little error is identified here. So because that is how the input patterns can be separated at best. Okay, so in most of the real-time problems, real-world problems, soft margin works well. By allowing a little error, we can divide the input patterns as best as possible. Okay, so that is what it is saying. Hard margin is, if the training data is linearly separable, then we can select two parallel hyperplanes that separate the two classes of data. So the distance between them is as large as possible, and the one class of input patterns will never belong to, or will never be identified as another class of input patterns in hard margin. Okay. Whereas in soft margin, because the most of the real world problems do not fit into this hard margin category, most of them falls into the soft margin category. We will allow some margin of violation to occur this soft margin classification. That means what we do is to have a large margin, even though some constraints are violated, we leave some error for it. Okay, so that is how it is identified. We left some error here by leaving these two green into this other side, and leaving this red into this other side. But the remained whatever class input patterns are there, they are best classified with this decision boundary, except this error allowed here. Okay. And margin violation means choosing a hyperplane which can allow some data points to stay in either incorrect side of hyperplane and between margin and correct side of hyperplane. Okay, that means we allow some of the input patterns to go beyond the hyperplane that moves to the other classification of other input pattern class. Okay, so these four, the good margin, bad margin, hard margin and soft margin are the types of margins that we can identify. The best margin is always preferred, but then in real world problems, it is not always possible to identify the best margin for a given set of input patterns. So we can go for soft margin with a little other anode on it. Okay. So now, having discussed about the fundamentals of linear SVM classifier, now it's time to see the algorithm for designing an SVM if the input patterns are linearly separable. Okay, so we'll go through the algorithm. It involves several steps. I'm giving these steps as just a formal sentences here. We'll see the technical implementation of this SVM, linear SVM, in our next session. Okay, so step one, what it is saying is, check whether the input patterns are linearly separable or not. So we know how to verify whether the input patterns are linearly separable or not. We'll try to draw a straight line to separate the input patterns into exactly two classes. If we succeed in drawing that straight line, then we can say that they are linearly separable. Okay, so if the input patterns are linearly separable, then we can design the linear SVM as I told earlier. Okay. So once we check this, if the input patterns are linearly separable, then in step two, we'll identify the support vectors that defines the boundaries of input class. So we know what is a support vector also. The closest points that belongs to each of the classes defined over there. That means for positive class, we'll identify the closest point to the positive hyperplane, and for negative class we will identify the closest point that is to the negative hyperplane. Sometimes there may be more than one support vector need to be considered for positive hyperplane and negative hyperplane. Okay, so we'll see this later when we solve a particular example. And once support vectors are identified, in step three, what we'll do is we'll find the values of Lagrange's multipliers, alpha I, using the equations that we discussed in our previous class. So I have explained how the quadratic optimization can be used to solve the linear SVM problem. So we use the same set of formulas that I explained there to find the values of those Lagrange's multipliers, alpha I, using the equations. Okay. And once the Lagrange's multiplier terms are identified, in step four, we will calculate the weight vector W that defines the equation of optimal hyperplane. So the goal of this linear SVM is to calculate this weight vector, which is defined as alpha I into Si into Sj. This tilde represents that the support vectors, Si and Sj, are support vectors. Augmented support vectors. Okay, so Si tilde means that augmented support vector I, and Sj tilde means that augmented support vector j. That becomes, that is equals to either plus one or minus one based on whether the support vector is representing the positive class or negative class. Okay, so don't worry, even if you do not understand this formula, I will explain this very clearly in our next session with a solid example. Okay. So this is the formula we are going to use. Try to remember this formula. Summation I is equals to 1 to k alpha I into Si tilde into Sj tilde is equals to plus or minus 1. Okay. So you will get a number of formulas here. By solving these formulas, you will get the values of these alpha I, that is multiplier terms, which will be used to calculate this weight vector W. Okay. So once we identify the weight vector, then we will identify a point through which the optimal hyperplane passes through. So this W represents the equation of optimal hyperplane, and then we need to identify the points through which this optimal hyperplane, that is a straight line, passes through. Okay, so once we identify it, we'll draw it because that is the optimal hyperplane, and we need to validate, that means we need to verify whether our linear SVM is working properly or not for a given set of inputs. That means in last step, we will validate the model. If it performs well, then we will leave the linear SVM as it is. Otherwise, we need to verify where the error has occurred. Okay, so these are the steps that will be used to design a linear SVM for linearly separable patterns. So always remember that a linear SVM is possible only if the input patterns are linearly separable. Okay. Right. So that's all for today. So what we discussed today is we started with an introduction to what is a linear SVM. What is a support vector machine, and then we have gone through the types of support vector machines. There are two types as explained. It is linear SVM and non-linear SVM. Linear SVMs are designed for the input patterns that are linearly separable, and non-linear SVMs are used to design for the non-linearly separable input patterns. Okay, and then we have gone through some terminology, the important terminology related to linear SVM, starting with what is a optimal hyperplane and what is a support vector. Optimal hyperplane is the best decision surface that provides the maximum margin between the positive hyperplane and the negative hyperplane. And also the support vectors are the closest points to the corresponding hyperplane. Okay, so then we saw several types of margins that can be identified with the SVM model. Okay, starting with a good margin, that is the best margin of separation, which allows us to provide the maximum margin between the closest points. Okay. And then we saw what is a bad margin also, in which the decision surface is very close to one class of input patterns and far away from the other class of input patterns. So we never recommend that bad margins, but if that is the only possibility, we have no other option. Okay. Then we saw two other categories, hard margin and soft margin. Hard margin is the margin that provides exactly two hyperplanes, that is positive hyperplane and negative hyperplane, that separates the input classes into exactly two classes. Okay, and the soft margin allows a little error that may allow one class of input patterns to go to the other side of the hyperplane. Okay, so with that little error, because the real world problems, most of the real world problems are complex problems that falls under non-linearly separable. So soft margin helps us in solving that kind of complex problems. Okay, so then we have seen the algorithm for designing a linear SVM, which contains six steps, starting with checking whether the input patterns are linearly separable or not, then identifying the support vectors that defines the boundaries of input class, and calculating the Lagrange's multiplier terms with the help of the equation summation I is equals to 1 to k alpha I into Si tilde into Sj tilde equals to plus or minus 1. And after identifying these equations and solving the equations, you will get the Lagrange's multiplier terms. And these Lagrange's multiplier terms will be used to calculate the weight vector in step 4. Once the weight vector is calculate it, we can find a point to pass through that defines the corresponding optimal hyperplane. And once your optimal hyperplane is identified, you need to validate the model whether it is working properly or not by inputting one of the input classes, input patterns, and whether the model is identifying into a proper class of input or not. That means if you provide a positive input pattern, then your model should identify it as a positive class. If you provide an input pattern from a negative class, then the model should identify the corresponding input pattern as a negative class input. Okay, so then we can say that the model is working fine. Our design is successful. Okay, so that is what I wanted to discuss today, the linear SVM fundamentals and the algorithm for designing linear SVM. And in our next class, we'll be discussing how a linear SVM can be designed for a particular example problem. So we'll consider an example problem, and then we will see how linear SVM can be designed step by step in our next class. That's all today. That's all for today. So thank you all for your patient listening. See you again in the next session. Thank you all once again.